This is Fam Electric Ghost, and we are live on our Twitch, Facebook, and YouTube channels with Leonardo, the space pianist. This is the first time we've had him on the show, and we're glad to have you. It's really cool to actually talk to people around the world. You're in Italy, right?
No, first of all, hello, Phantom, and hello, everybody. I'm Italian, and I live in Malta, which is a small island in the middle of the Mediterranean, not so far from the south of Italy.
Oh, okay, so you're on that island.
I lived here 5 years ago.
Okay, yeah, sorry about that. I always mess up on that sometimes. But
no problem.
So you are a pianist, a composer, and an aerospace engineer. We'll probably talk more about the music than that, unless you want to talk about that. one of your things in your write-up is you want to play the first piano concert on Mars, which is probably could happen in the next 30 years.
Yes, I'm targeting 20. So
yeah, because so, I mean, that's pretty cool. We're just trying to get back.
No, I guess it's a hard thing. One of the challenges, but this is why the space pianist, because it took me some years, but I don't live as a dichotomy. My legs call it a double nature as a musician and a scientist. I'm very passionate about creating music, but also about aerospace subjects. So I dream to be part of this new space era with the first human travels to Mars, setting up a first colony there. And I dream of doing, and I'm targeting, so I'm not just only dreaming, of doing there the first piano concert.
I wonder how a piano would react in Mars gravity. Would it actually sound similar, or would it change the way it sounds?
So technically speaking, to perform a traditional acoustic piano in the atmosphere of Mars would be pretty challenging because, first of all, if I would be outside, I will need to wear
a suit. You have to be in a dome. I'm assuming you'd be in a dome, and the dome would mirror Earth.
Yes. Now, in a dome, ideally there would be something similar to, not similar, something like the air we breathe here on Earth, because as humans, we are pretty limited in the selection of gas that we can keep on living.
It would be like we'd have to build like an underwater dome in the ocean to kind of mirror what the kind of dome would be on Mars, you know. I think if you build a dome in the middle of the ocean, it would simulate.
As a concept, there are actually some simulations of building some domes in deserts, like also in the US.
Yeah.
And the difference is that the atmosphere of Mars is like roughly 1% as a density in comparison with the one on Earth, plus with elements that are not so human friendly. Also, there will be a reduced gravity. So for a traditional acoustic piano, considering all the challenges to make it, to travel till there, not only—
You probably want a synthesizer instead. You probably bring like a Roland RD piano. Just to make sure that you can play it.
That could be a trade-off as a first concert. We will see. To have a stairway grand piano would be nice. And inside a dome would be feasible. And there will be also some changes because I will experience a different gravity.
Yeah, I wonder how that would be. So, like how could you would it affect how your finger because of the gravity?
The muscles will be, let's say, oversized in strength when you arrive there because on Earth the gravity is superior. So actually the performances should be better.
Oh, wow. I want to hear that. Because being a pianist myself, you know, or a synthesizer player, I have to play on a piano.
Now, the issue is that when you leave Earth and you are already like the astronauts in the International Space Station, you have, after a period of time, the effects of living in
zero gravity,
microgravity.
Yeah.
Let's call it microgravity. So different issues related with the space environment. So imagine the trip to arrive to Mars, plus the adaptation period. So there are, in reality, a lot of challenges.
Yeah, I wonder,
engineers and scientists.
I don't think people have...
But it's fascinating.
Yeah, people haven't even thought about, like, well, how would you play guitar? How would you play drums? Like, you know, a drummer with their drumsticks, like on a drum, how is that going to react?
The bounce will be definitely different.
Yeah, they'd have to probably relearn
unless, how you play. That and the plus you can redesign a traditional drum kit to keep, the same proportion.
Yeah.
So heavier sticks, heavier components to have more or less the same feeling. But as humans, as musicians, it's true. Also we are very quick
to adapt. We're trying to adapt. Yeah, once people get to Mars, all the musicians will adapt. And you have all these like Mars-specific like instruments.
yes. But now we we smile because it looks like something very far. But actually, in 20-30 years, 20-30 years can be something that will be our... not daily view, but something that we can experience inside this generation.
Yeah, I really believe that technology is advancing so much that, you know, I can see that. Now, the type of piano you have behind you, what is that? Is that a Steinway?
Not yet. Let me move. I have to mirror the camera. No, this is a Petrov, half grand, a nice Petrov. But I play looking at the sea. Now there are the curtains here because I am on the side where there will be the sunset. But at the moment, the sunlight is super strong. So there will be just a huge amount of light and heat also coming through the window. But you can check on my Instagram or my YouTube channel. There are many videos with the sea in the background. So my next step is to upgrade it to a Steinway D. So also this is in my plans.
That's cool. Well, it's actually nice to see in this age of everybody using, like, you know, computers to record. It's cool to see artists actually using acoustic instruments, you know, that, like, I love to see, you know, people playing guitars and basses and, you know, drummers playing drums. And, you know, I haven't actually interviewed, like a cello player and a harpsichord player and some other like classical instrument musicians. But it is, it's really cool to actually, you know, talk to somebody that actually plays a real piano.
And I love also to record it with home recording. And as a space pianist, here I have a Korg Kronos plus also a Theremin.
Yeah.
In my music, I merge both. Plus, it depends from what I'm composing, but I also use VST samples. So it depends on what I am working on.
Yeah, I guess we won't go into the stuff that I'm into. I'm into the, like the modular analog world. We won't go into there. but you know, I'm sure one day, since you're an engineer, you'd probably get into it. But
this is in my roadmap to learn more about modular synthesis. But for now, my knowledge is very small.
Well, having an analog, a real analog instrument like a piano, they gives you a pass.
Okay.
Because that's a good enough. Like, all analog tries to do is tries to be more like your piano. You know, it tries to allow electronic musicians to have something that has that feels more natural than digital, because it seems more organic. Even though it's still electronic, it has some aspects that feel like an acoustic instruments, which is why we use it, because it tends to allow us to do stuff like that. Especially when it comes to like basses and horns and stuff, we can get sounds that are closer to that, in our opinion. But I wanted to show people your music, because one cool thing we like to do is actually we're going to show a YouTube video that we're queuing up, and it's for your Seed Island teaser. And we're going to play that. We'll put you on mute. We're going to play it, and then we'll come back and we'll ask you the questions that we sent you. Okay?
Sure.
Okay, so I'm going to put you on mute now, and then we'll play this. So that was a really cool teaser video. So I think that gives people a good example. What we like to do is on this this video podcast, what we couldn't do on the audio podcast, because we've been doing podcasting since 2018, and we started audio only. And the audio only platform didn't allow us to share people's music. We could talk about it, but people never heard any of the music that we were talking about. We were just talking to the artist about their process without anybody getting to hear it. And so what we like in this version is that we're able to show people not only that they can hear it, but they can see if you have a YouTube video, so they get an idea what your whole, how you present yourself, which I think is a good way to introduce your audience. You know, people get to see what your whole stage craft is about, which we think is important. So I wanted to get into the beginning of all the questions I ask every artist. So when did you first get into music? Like what age?
I was pretty young, let's say. I was around 6 years old. Actually, I had my first experiences with music with a toy piano when I was 3 years old. And not only with music, because probably I had also already some inspiration for engineering, because I remember dismantling, disassembling that toy piano, so not only playing it. But I started to move my first steps in music between 6 and 7 years old. And I fell in love with the piano when I saw it. I saw my first piano in the primary school that I was attending the first year. And there was this very old upright piano in a room that was not so much used. And when I discovered it there, I fell in love. So after, also thanks to my family that supported the first steps, I started to study piano. So these were the very first steps. And after, I started, let's say, seriously to study music from when I was around 12, 13 years old. And after that, I never stopped to do it every day and enjoying it a lot. Now I'm 37, so a few years past.
So when you first started, did you start with classical? You know, were you trained as a classical pianist?
Yes. Yes, my background is as a classical pianist. I started with classical music, and I also in Italy attended the music conservatory, so I got my degree in piano. So a big part of my background, of my roots, is in classical music.
When did you start to integrate like rock and popular music into your style? Because you've taken like the classical background, but you've integrated it with the guitars, and you know, as a space pianist, it seems like you brought in like progressive rock.
That is a long process that happened during the years, but just to talking about the first steps, I discovered Queen when I was 9 years old.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good example.
Operatic. I was listening to like innuendo. I heard the voice of Freddie Mercury. So it was like an epiphany for me. And later, in parallel with classical music, I discovered Joe Satriani, the music of Joe Satriani, Steve Vai, also Robert Miles. That when I was in middle school, gave me the first inspiration for more, let's say, to be more on the electronic side of music. So I remember I had a very old and entry-level Technics synthesizer, but call it a synth is a little bit an overreach, but it was a very, very good instrument to have, because I was able to start to see the first synthesized instruments, splitting voices, doing some basic stuff that later I developed more when I discovered Dream Theater and Jordan Rudess. That was another epiphany along my path along music. Mm-hmm. And during the years, I also studied for some years compositions and contemporary music composition. So all of these influences helped to become what the musician that I am nowadays. So here was Seed, which is part of the last EP that I published, Island. And is not the only type of music that I do, which means I'm always in this big dome to keep that image of what I call contemporary space music. But on my Spotify, for example, there are different type of compositions that you can hear, listen to also different type of influences.
So when you collaborate, have you collaborated with like singers to bring vocals into your music, just to let the fans, people know?
First of all, my music, 99% mainly is instrumental. But talking about singers, recently, I mean, a few months ago, I had a very nice collaboration with Mariangela De Murtas, which is a lead singer of Tristania, of the band Ardus. So she's an international singer. And we met thanks to Yossi Sassi, which is the ex-co-founder of Oriental Progressive Metal Band Orphan Erland. So for who is in following that that type of music, know what I am talking about. So we are both top level musicians. So besides this, and besides some other collaboration in the past, I also did a collaboration with Aliki, which was 2013, I think, the winner of Britain Got Talent. We did a collaboration actually also due to the first lockdown. Mm-hmm. But regarding my music, primarily most of times instrumental. It is what I enjoy most, and what I publish, maybe.
I think like when I started the ghost stuff that I do, I never had vocals. I would say like I'm in my 50s, like the first like 10 years of doing the work I was doing, there was no vocals on it at all. It was all just like ambient, experimental, progressive electronic with no vocals on it. And then I made a decision that like, in order to get to a certain audience, there's a certain type of audience that wants to hear vocals. They won't listen to anything if it doesn't have vocals. So I said, well, I want to try to create this kind of more new wave, new romantic, maybe with a punk edge. But I also noticed with your work, you work with visual artists, you work with dancers.
Yes.
And that's, so have you ever worked with like film directors or theaters beside, you know, to do backup, to do music for plays or for, you know, one act plays or for projects other than your own music? Has your music been used for other people's work, like visually?
Besides a few collaborations, but this years ago, like a soundtrack for documentaries or a commission for like music for some background music for videos. Mainly when I worked for a show for theaters, for that type of environment, was for projects that I developed. What was in that video? Is a video from a show that I developed in collaboration with two dancers, a visual artist, and a guitarist as a core team that was performed in a theater here in Malta. So I bring my own creations. So I'm, and that was a show for contemporary space music with a strict connection between dance and visuals. So
yeah, performance art. It's really, so when you play live, is it always like performance art? Do you always work with dancers, or do you do performances where you don't have dancers or visual arts?
So not necessary. So it's now around 10 years that in different occasions I collaborated with several dancers. And also for different type of shows on which I worked on based on my music. Depends also from the context, from the situation. But let's say before this pandemic was half-half, let's say, for the live performances. Like in videos, if you check the video clips I released since 2018. There are many times dancers, but for example, I did a two experimental video with two people performing yoga and acrobatic yoga. That's cool. So different
performance different art is interesting. I've always been a big fan of performance art. You know, I've always been like the people I was inspired by was like Andy Warhol and like Lou Reed. When they had their collaboration together, they there was a whole history in New York where they had all these experimental musicians like the Velvet Underground, and then they had Warhol, and he'd have these big screens of his art, like visual versions of his paintings, going up on screens, and then having actors and dancers all participate in these like happenings. And then also like Frank Zappa used to do very experimental stuff in the late 60s and 70s with the Mothers of Invention, where they would link up with visual artists and dancers in San Francisco and do these big visual shows. And I've always been very inspired by that kind of progressive nature of that. And so a lot of the stuff I do is, you know, inspired by that. And maybe I don't have dancers yet, but I've always thought about integrating what you're doing in a kind of a science fiction way. Because a lot of what I do is very science fiction based. It's very like Isaac Asimov, you know, Ray Bradbury.
One of my inspirations in life, Isaac Asimov.
yeah. So I understand where you're coming from. So let me get to more of the questions. So you started, you know, with the piano. You eventually got into synthesizers. You got into recording on your own. So we'll get to the question about like the DAW at some point. But when did you decide, you know, you learn piano, you learn classical music. A lot of times people that learn piano, they go and they play in an orchestra and they play Beethoven and Bach and Chopin, and, you know, they don't write their own music. So that is a very kind of big difference, you know, usually between like a pop star and a classical musician. They tend to stay in the lane of, I'm only going to play like classical music. What made you want to write your music in more of a pop way, that you were not just going to do Beethoven and Bach, that you were actually going to write your own compositions?
So I think that, first of all, music industry and the music scenario is changing a lot in these years. Also, in a natural way, I try to see things without strict boundaries. And if we think, basically, playing Beethoven, Brahms, Schubert as a pianist in public is basically doing covers. So
yeah, covers. And, you get bored with that. I think any musician would get bored with that.
At the time of, for example, Liszt with his concerts, of course, the level of music performed, but also, let's go,
you have to be
Stravinsky. The level of music, of course, is much higher, in my opinion, in complexity.
Yeah, and I think that's the point. You're doing music, covers, but you're doing such complicated music that people go to see you like they go to see opera, right? You go to see an opera.
Actually, you can have also, there are incredible jazz musicians where you can say a lot of things, but that is not that it's easy music. There are also metal bands which
have classical bands. Classical bands
is really, really complicated. So it's true that I play every day classical music. It's part of my background, but also my routine. As
now a composer
and a musician, the roots for me is very important, that are there to get energy, artistic energy. But actually, maybe it was because I started relatively young, so liking classical music and rock, metal.
Well, like a Queen. But I think like, if you see, like, I love Queen because the integration of the piano and Freddie Mercury's kind of operatic voice, and then choices like in Bohemian Rhapsody to actually make it like make an opera,
yes,
make a rock opera.
Sure, that is a level of pop that nowadays is difficult to reach, but in any case, we can consider it pop and at a different level music. What I think is that due to the previous century mainly, there was a progressive detachment from the musician, which is a performer. There are, of course, huge performers around the world, but also the musician that is a composer and proposes his own music.
A so singer-songwriter.
I always supported the idea of a musician that, yes, does covers for fun or his own study for to have a historical insight, which is very important, but also in creating music. It's also true that there are excellent classical musicians that, if it is asked them, for example, to improvise, are not able to do it. Not, in my opinion, because they don't have the competencies,
or it's not part of their it's not part of the structure of music, you know.
Yes, it's a part of an attitude that requires, of course, some time to be developed. So it's more related to the mental boundaries we put in something, and of course there can be who decides to specialize in a historical study of Baroque music, for example. It does only that. I mean, there are really a lot of possibilities, and whenever is intellectual honesty in following a path, I think everything enriches a lot the world of music.
Well, I think the thing that's interesting about, you know, music today, like I call what I do call expansive sound. And the idea of expansive sound is like I can bring in classical, I can bring in jazz, I can bring in punk rock, I can do new wave, I can do everything. So I don't want to have a boundary. So I basically say it's expansive, which means I can bring any genre in and do whatever I want. And so that seems to be a lot of what's going on today. There's like, you know, mixing between hip hop and jazz and rock and hip hop and punk and rock, and everything's crossing over. So there's a lot.
Actually, as humans, we try to put a lot of boundaries and say, this is team A, this is team B. But basically what you are expressing is the concept of MMA, mixed martial arts, where thanks to that, now in MMA, there is a real mix of different martial arts that according to the situation, during a fight, in that case, there is one style which is better than another. But for example, MMA had the very good aspect of cleaning some fake martial arts. And I think also, yes, because there are some martial arts which are basically just
for film.
Being in a circus act, let's say for film, for movies. So the good thing is also in music. Nowadays, there are some very talented musicians that create music, can deal with different languages. And also this is somehow cleaning the stereotype of the musician that only does a certain type of thing, that...
I think a good example, if you think about it, right, in electronic music today, when people say electronic music, right, they think like EDM, techno, trance, right? When I say electronic music, I go back to Keith Emerson, right? Mm-hmm. I go back to like, yes, Rick Wakeman, you know, I go back to Genesis, like, you know, Tony Banks. So my idea of electronic music is like having a big Moog modular on stage with Keith Emerson with this giant Moog, or Pete Townsend with his EMS on like Barbara O'Reilly or Won't Get Fooled Again, you know, or like even if you think about Stevie Wonder playing Saturn on the songs The Key of Life with a famous synthesizer, the GX1 Yamaha, that created the song like Village Ghetto Land and Saturn. And those songs on Stevie Wonder's album were created with some of the first analog polyphonic synthesizers. And the big difference with that is that type of electronic music was like pushing boundaries, because when Stevie Wonder did Saturn, he could have used violins, he could have used a real orchestra, he could have had Motown do that. But he decided to do the violin sounds, the string sounds on an analog polyphonic synth, which didn't really sound like real strings. It sounded more other world because the song was called Saturn, right? So it was trying to be Saturn. So if he used violins, it would be something that was like a known thing on Earth. But the synth had this sound that was kind of otherworldly. And that's kind of where I kind of come from in the music that I do, is the depths of what synthesizers can do. And whether they're polyphonic, analog, digital, granular, modular, whatever. It's electronic music to me is the source of the tone.
But if you think I'm highlighting that I really love the concept of wood metal creating, for example, the sound in a piano, a classical instrument like a piano, a violin, a guitar is basically an analog synth with a limited range of sounds available. And it is really fascinating when electronic developed, given what we have nowadays, which are huge possibilities, because of course it is much easier to manage a
machine
electronic
than a big orchestra
to create No, not only that, but to create sounds that would be unfeasible or very hard to reach with a combination of wood, metal, and so on. So also a piano has its own sample.
Yeah, yeah.
The fact is that, for example, I love to feel, perceive the real vibration in the structure of a piano when I play, and you get them back in your... in your body.
Do you play with different tunings on your piano? Because I know that you can tune pianos in very specific ways. Do you play with like alternative tunings?
No. For my piano, I keep the 430 and the normal temperament. But and I'm not fan of the trend of tuning at 442, so a little bit higher as pitch for the central A. What I did many times since concert is what I call a not invasive piano preparation, which means I change in an analogic way the sound of a piano with different objects here and there on the strings. It's true that marginally, of course, an object affects the tuning, but it's not like the preparations of John Cage, where it was a heavy modification of the sound. And also in Island, there is one composition, which is for prepared piano and synth plus guitar, where also the guitar is having fun with a different type of sounds that are not of a traditional rock.
Like effect sounds. Effect control. Do you ever do a lot of effects on your piano? Do you
run this was the next thing that I was going to tell. Another thing that now I did for the first time in concert live, I think 2018, so 3 years ago, not so long ago. Where I like also to, I call it a hacked piano.
That's a good term. I like that. I never heard that.
Which, I mean, is a term that I borrowed from a musician that I really admire. He's an experimental pianist, Ron Minis. He's based in Tel Aviv.
Well, that's cool. Israel. That's good to know.
And he's a really interesting pianist. I will send you later.
I'd like to check that out.
That's a really interesting music. And he uses techniques different from mine and also more complicated, if I have to say. But I got an inspiration. And during live concerts for some compositions, I connect a microphone, taking the sound of the piano to the Core Kronos, that also has a stability, latency, is a very solid instrument for that. And I program a patch where I have up to 16 between filters, effects, equalization, and so on. So what comes out from the overall sound system is, of course, the normal sound of the piano, but with a layer of what it is, the so-called hacked piano. And in some cases, I did also the step further, always merging with the synth, doing a prepared piano, hacking that prepared sound, and adding a synth. So I like to experiment and to see what comes out, but of course, when I am at home, I do all type possible of experimentation. When I am alive, I choose what is functional for
what's actually
of the show.
Yeah, that's a good quite thing because I know being an experimental musician myself, there's stuff I can do in my studio, but then it's it might not be possible to do it live because it's too complicated. I might have too many things going on that it might be too unstable to be able to use it. That in a recording environment, I can do it because I don't have to worry because I can get back to it. But if I have to do a live performance and I'm running filters into envelopes into random voltage generators and doing all this stuff, that's very complicated in the modular kind of world is we can go crazy down the rabbit hole with all these triggers. We can create triggers that trigger another trigger, does another trigger.
Yes.
If you know your aerospace technology, like if you get into algorithms and you just keep on building them and you become like totally crazy, right? So the idea
the problem is that if something goes wrong live, the bug in real time is something that I really don't recommend.
Well, the problem with like some of these analog things is that they can get really hot, right? The volume could go and kind of blow things up, right? So if you're playing with very experimental stuff, the range on your bass could go so low it could blow something out. You could go so high that you could blow something out. So you don't you got to be careful with what you do, because the limitations on some of the analog stuff is kind of like it's not like it's a Kronos. Mm-hmm. You're kind of taking a raw oscillator and you're doing whatever you want, and there's no computer controlling what it's doing. So if you go too crazy with all the permutations, you can blow things out. But you just got to be careful. But it's interesting that you've kind of taken some trigger ideas of taking that into your hack piano, into your Kronos, and running through like the signal chain and getting different effects to happen. That's pretty cool. And I imagine that when you called yourself the space pianist, that you were going to use some electronic music capabilities to hack your piano or alter your piano sound.
Mm-hmm. Yes, this is the direction that I am having above all in the last 3 years, and this merger between the traditional piano that I still love as a main source for when I play, because also for the physical sensations, plus all the electronic part, and of course in a studio production, the flexibility is much higher also in managing the sounds.
So I like to ask people who their influences are and their reference points. Now, I know you wrote them down, but we're going to ask you like the talk about, we already talked about Queen was an inspiration, and you talked about some of the other artists that you, I think you said you mentioned like Steve Vai and Robert Miles. So maybe you could talk about
as a starting point. Now in many years in music, influences are actually a lot. I mean, I think I am very open since always in listening a lot of different type of musicians, composers, and so on. If I wanted to say which is my main influence, is more than a musician, actually for me is the only god that I recognize, which is Johann Sebastian Bach. Mm-hmm. And the impact that, in my opinion, Bach has still nowadays is huge. So it is only composer that literally every day I play some of
so that's how you warm up, you practice, that's how you play Bach to warm up or get yourself in the zone
I every day I target to have a session of dedicated to classical music, both for the technique but also for my personal development. Mm-hmm. And because also plan. Training as a classical musician as some insights that, in my opinion, you don't have following other streams only.
Yeah.
And so Bach is the only constant. Later, I can decide to switch between Beethoven, Debussy, Schubert, Mozart, and so on, according also to what I'm focusing on in a certain period or not. But Bach is always constant. Plus, from a classical side of view, when I was younger, but not only, Beethoven had a great influence. Brahms, later when I was more grown up, I really discovered the amazing music of Stravinsky, but also Ligeti, Arvo Pärt, which is a contemporary composer that is really groundbreaking with what he created and is still creating. On the other side, of course, as a teenager, I was listening to a lot of rock, progressive rock. So we already mentioned Sundance TV, the theater, Queen. I mean, to start, but still now I listen to very, very heavy metal bands, which are not, I mean, not the usual metal band, but because yes, you hear many times mentioned Metallica, but not only. I have some very heavy listening on that. I also regarding jazz. I got another epiphany when I discovered Thelonious Monk.
Oh, Monk! Yeah, Monk's awesome. I'm kind of a big fan of an American band called Sun Ra. I've heard of Sun Ra. I'm very much into because they're kind of they're not highly known, right? So they're
peace. I know them. I know them.
You know them, but I mean, but their critics love them, right? But not everybody in the jazz community knows their pieces like they know Monk or they know Miles or they know Coltrane. They they, you know, it's kind of like an underground. Like critics love them. The critics think they're awesome, but not everybody in the public knows all their pieces. And, you know, they kind of, I've been very inspired by them because they were actually, I don't know if you know, they were one of the first jazz bands to actually get a Moog in the late 50s. Robert Moog actually asked them if they wanted to use one of his first invented Moogs. And they were one of the only like jazz bands that looked at it and said, okay, yeah, we can use that. A lot of jazz bands looked at them and said, well, we don't want this because it's not real, right? So they were like, nobody wanted it, but Sun Ra was willing to look at it. And they actually incorporated it into their music in the late 50s, which nobody else had done that. And it was a big inspiration to me because when I listen to those pieces, it's like the first use of synthesizer in a jazz band. And it's really incredible because it's how they approached it was totally different than anybody else. It's like the first band to do it. And they just came at it at a different angle than anybody. Like before Herbie Hancock. This is like way before Herbie Hancock. And he's like known for it. But Sun Ra did it in the late 50s. He did it in the 70s. You know, so this is way ahead of that. So... yeah, so that's kind of where my head's at, but
also nowadays, if I check to my playlist, I mean, if I check to the last week, I am switching between Brahms, Schubert. Cool. I was listening also the symphonies of Sibelius. The latest album of Gojira, Ginger.
You're heavy into it. You're a true devotee of the craft.
Chicoria. I mean,
Korea. He's awesome. Yes, awesome.
Unfortunately, I saw him live three years ago, and when awesome. I saw that he left. This planet, I was pretty sad to.
Yeah, yeah. But to lose a guy like that, you know, it's like
such a great musician. And, also, I mean, it happened with also other great musicians. But having the opportunity to see him live, I saw him live also at the Blue Note in Milano, is something really touching. And Vera, at least personally, I understand why. A great musician is a great musician.
Because, yeah, like I saw
there are a lot of nuances, details that makes the difference from, let's say, a normal human musician and
I think my good example of that is I actually saw Prince like three times.
Okay.
Right. And he's an amazing multi-instrument player. Right? He can play drums really well. People didn't realize how good he can play drums. He can play, you know, the bass as good as like Bootsy Collins. He could play, you know, keyboards almost as good as like Stevie Wonder. And think of he created like the Minneapolis funk sound, which right is a variation of Parliament Funkadelic and James Brown and Sly and the Family Stone. So it wasn't like he invented funk, but he took something that existed in funk and reworked it to be like funk. Funk bands would do like 10, 15 minute songs. He was able to take funk and bring it down to like a 3-4 minute pop song that actually was like more advanced than what most pop songs are in terms of the rhythmic structure. It was something new. It was a variation in funk. That's like the way James Brown created like the funk idea. It's a different timing structure than what most music is. And so that to have a guy at that level, and I saw him play at Paisley Park, his house, his studio. Okay. And he could channel, you know, Santana, he could channel Hendrix, and then he had his own style. And it was like a mixture of all that. And I'd see him, it was like a three-piece like rock outfit, like just a bass player and a drummer, right? And he could play heavy, heavy rock, blues-based rock, Stevie Ray Vaughan, Hendrixian type of rock. He could do it. And then he could jump on a piano and play really awesome like chord progressions that were like Motown songs. And then he could go on a synthesizer and play stuff at a level I've never seen anybody play before. So it's like the being able to jump on so many different instruments and then have a range on his voice where he had really good range, really high falsetto, good mid-range, good low range. And I just never seen somebody have that level of skill before.
Okay. No, but you are talking some of the musicians that touched my heart that came up to my mind while you were talking about these inspirations. And it is also why I'm into the music. My music project is called Nullo Dies Sine Nota, which is Latin for Not a Day Without a Note. It's my own project. My main music project since 2006. And it is also thanks to inspirations like the one that we mentioned, that every day I'm happy to do music. Till now, I never got bored one single day. So.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it's awesome to be able to, you know, as a creative person, create your own, you know, craft to actually, you know, because not everybody has the ability to create music. Not everybody is a creative person. And it's interesting, you know, where people ask, I've asked people like, you know, do you feel that you get your inspiration from like a muse? Like, you know, poets talked about like this muse, right? This universal idea that if you're a poet, that you pick up on these ideas, it's just out in the universe. You just pick it up, right? And you pull it into, you can channel it.
Spirit, so-called spirit of time. I don't know how to
render. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Do you feel that? Do you feel that, or do you feel it's a lot from practice? Everything you're getting from practice?
Sure, I would like, not for you, because you already know, but for who is listening and maybe is not an artist, a musician, I would like also from myself to debust the myth that creativity, inspiration comes just like a gift. It the creativity, yes, is a gift, but it can't come to this world without a craft, a consistency that you build up in the years and every day. So magic, in my opinion, doesn't happen just because of magic. As also at every level, because everyone has a different level. I'm not talking just about the huge names in the world of art, but to create, it is a grueling process of being there every day and learn the craft and improve that metaphorical 1% more every day. And after 1,000 days, you can look back and see this improvement. Basically, you learn and develop a language that allows to express yourself. Regarding the inspiration, I think that, of course, we are not, no one is No man is an island. We are not a standalone system. We have the influences from everywhere, mm-hmm. and above all, in this digital society, we are exposed to all sorts of inputs, and also for the brain is difficult to filter. So when we see some type of art emerging in the world, I think it's even more than in the past that there is, let's say, something in the air that every artist elaborates according to his own sensitivity. Talking about from where idea comes, human brain is very fascinating and super complex, most likely the most complex mechanism that we know of. So it's like the brain trying to understand itself.
Yeah.
And probably in this process, we create art. And in this art, there is also the big stream of music. This is how I see things. Is there a way to try to
explain it? It's hard to explain. To express it. Yeah. Well, I think a lot of people would say, like, you know, James Brown. He said that, like, his craft was because he worked hard. He basically said he was the hardest working person in show business because he had. It's like, you know, if you're an athlete, right? If you're an athlete, you have muscle memory because you practice, right?
Yes.
So you practice that 3-point shot. You practice trying to do the home run, right? You practice your skill. I think every musician has that kind of muscle memory. Like if you're a guitar player, you practice so much it becomes like you don't have to look at the guitar. If you're a piano player, you don't even have to look at it. You just know it, right? Because you have the muscle memory. You've just been doing it, and you just got the skill set. So you. The things that you learn. And then what happens, like with creativity, what I like to do is like these stream of consciousness, like just jam sessions with myself, right? I'll just put the recorder on and I'll just go to my synthesizers and just start playing and record it. And I don't know where I'm going to go because in my head, I might have a John Coltrane sax line in my head, in my subconscious, and it might come out of my synth. Because I was thinking about it, right? Or I might pull a chord arrangement that was like from the Beatles, and because it's in my head, and it just pops in at some point.
It was something that entered in your brain like 10 years earlier, and
yeah, it just pops in. Yeah, but you have no idea when these things pop in. But I think musicians, I think we are good listeners. We listen to our gut, right? So if you're a musician, what I tend to I've kind of figured out is like you when you're a really good musician, you just let yourself kind of just be open to whatever is coming. Like you listen to a drummer, right? You're playing with a drummer, and then suddenly, okay, I know what goes with that, right? You listen to the singer, you know how to put a chord arrangement around the singer's voice. You just like you start to just figure out things, and you can just. You go with what your gut tells you or what your ear tells you, and you learn how to fit things together, and you can do it in a way where you don't have to necessarily stop and start and stop and start. Like I played a lot of jazz with a lot of jazz guys, right? And we just kind of jump into something and we kind of go, we all go off and then we come back. The idea in jazz is like you'll have a theme, right? You'll do the theme and then you go off. And you kind of solo, and then you come back to the theme. You could change the time signature. You could change the key. You just bounce around. But everybody knows when to come back to the main theme and then go back out and come back in. And it just it feels really cool when you're with people who can actually play that. They know how to, like, if I play with that drummer, he'll follow me. If I play with the bass player, he'll follow me, or I'll follow him. Or the horn player will follow me, or I'll follow him. And it's kind of like an unwritten language. You look at them, you nod your head, you do it. People just kind of know. And I think maybe that's the thing. Maybe classical musicians have a harder time doing that because they don't do that. But you know, rock musicians and jam band and jazz musicians.
For example, really grateful when I was a teenager, I did a lot of jams, bavola with rock and metal musicians because that really helped me to open more my mind. Yeah. And an example of building the craft and feeling, following the so-called gut feeling, it happened recently because On Wednesday, there will be a new release, a single, and it is an experimental creation done with what for me is a God-level drummer, Marco Minneman, which for me is a really one of the best drummers that I also listen to, but also saw live. And I saw also Billy Cobham live, so I'm mm-hmm. I have comparisons, but Marco Minneman is a really a great musician. And this composition that I'm releasing on Wednesday was born from basically a jam, because I did an improvisation at the drum. Very, very experimental.
Cool.
And I put the piano and synth and effects. And when I was creating on it, the inspiration was flowing, thankfully supported by technique and knowing how to do mm-hmm. to do things. So it came out, in my opinion, an interesting experiment that surprised also myself, because I was really inspired by what Marco Minneman did. So, and they also commented that was a nice final result.
I think it's just fun to do improv because I'm a big, you know, I think I talk about Frank Zappa, and Frank Zappa, like he was known that like he would never play any of his solos for any of his songs the same way, just because he would be bored, right? So he said, like, I could play it the same way, but I'm not, because if I go play, I wrote this song and I own it, and I'm going to do it the way I want. And the way I want to do it is every night I'm going to change it.
And it was up, but basically it was the same approach of what are now the composers that we say we cannot touch, but there are historical proof that Liszt, also Beethoven, Mozart, when they were playing, not only for the so-called cadenze at the end of the concert and so on, but the music, that they were playing their own music, and after a certain era, not only, was something alive, something in continuous evolution. So composing is a dynamic, is a dynamic process, and not something like most of classical music world is something, let's say, crystallized in something that cannot be changed. And also, there is to put this at extreme, considering something like correct. I mean, for sure, there are practices in playing a music of the past that are more correct and according to that time, but basically not having recordings of that, no one can.
No one knows exactly what they exactly.
Something was performed, and also, we have a sheet music where, for example, in a music score, Stravinsky was very precise in specifying mm-hmm. What he wanted, because Corey was not trusting who was going to play it. But if you see music scores of not only Bach, but also Mozart and so on, they were confident that the musicians of the time were knowing
they knew what it is, like,
in jazz. Yeah. But also that was not something that you cannot touch. Not saying that if I touch something, it's because I am at the level of Mozart.
No, I think it's just, but, I think it's more
to say that the music is something alive.
Yeah, it's a living thing. It's like a painter. A painter is never going to paint the same way, right? So I think of music a lot of times when I do synthesizer music, right? We think of it as sound painting. Right. A lot of synthesizer modules.
Like
especially modular synthesizers, because the one thing we would like to say about it is that they are very point in time. The nature of modular synthesizers is they every day they sound different. And what you do with a modular synth is you let the synth talk to you and you use what it gives you. You don't try to control it and say, oh, I want to make you into something else. You take what it gives you and you go with it, right? So if today it gives me a certain sound, I might go with that and create a composition because that's the way it was behaving. And then the next day, my Moog might act a little different, so I'm going to go a different direction. And it's very improvisational. It's very jazz-like. And so a lot of us modular synthesis, we kind of like, oh, it's a painting. It's like, I'm going to do it today. I paint it. It's going to be what I feel and what the instrument is giving me today. What it gives me tomorrow, I don't know. You know, that's kind of what it is. But I always like to give a little bit of a description of you know, how people come across things. But it's interesting what you brought in, that everybody thinks classical music is written on the page. It was played on the page, and you just pointed out that maybe it wasn't. And I think that's really interesting.
But the music score, above all, before the, let's call it, modern age, was a reference. So
yeah, it's a reference
because there was an assumption that the musicians knew this, let's call them standards and modus operandi, and also because it was something alive. So above all, the composer itself knew its music. Beethoven was known to be a great improviser, and himself wrote that when he was playing in living room concerts of rich people. I was doing on purpose. It was enjoying the process of bringing them to tears, thanks to his improvisation. And he was, let's say, making fun of this because he was really aware of the process. Mm-hmm. So also Liszt, a great improviser. I mean, every great composer was also a great improviser. And so it is naive to believe that when they were creating something and proposing that in concert, everything was exactly like the published music. Later, there was, of course, the market of published music.
Yeah, yeah.
So all buying the music and playing as it was written, till arriving to the recordings, so where things were recorded, and everything went to extremes here and there. This is why I support the idea of a musician that studies and can have fun in doing covers. Basically, an orchestra is a huge cover
band. Yeah, it's like a bar band.
Yes, I mean, there are cover bands, cover bands of Metallica, and there are cover bands of Mozart.
Yeah, the cover bands of the Beatles. To me, it's like there are cover bands of the Beatles, right? Like Beatlemania, yes. Right? And then there's actually like Badfinger or like Big Star that actually, or, you know, they took the Beatles sound and then made their own version of it. Right.
Yes, because there are some versions actually that are even better than the original. So
yeah,
it's like nowadays playing Bach on the modern piano is not historically accurate, of course.
Yeah, yeah.
Playing, I mean, also the music of Beethoven itself on a modern piano is not historically accurate. But everything is evolving, and there is an important work of, let's call it, music archaeology, where you're try to recover what is nearer as possible.
Yeah, I think some people see their
original sound. But there is the evolution and also the world of synth, the huge possibilities that nowadays we have, the huge possibility that there are in post-production, in live concerts. So music, like humanity, is something that in continuous evolution and something dynamic alive. So putting... I am against putting things into fossils.
I understand. Because one thing that's interesting that I like to talk to people about, and we'll probably have to close it because we've gone over an hour, but when we get into the idea of like working in digital audio workstations, so do you do a lot of work like in a DAW, or do you do mostly work in a studio? Do you do a lot of work in your home studio within like Ableton or Pro Tools, and then go to a big like professional studio and finish the song at the professional studio?
No, so above all, due to the pandemic and the lockdowns that we were also here in Malta, I increased a lot the work in my home studio that I also upgraded. And basically, I record my piano with two Rode NT5 microphones, and I use as interface a Zoom F810 that I really love as interface. Mm-hmm. Is really powerful. have also a Zoom H6n, which is actually the one I'm using as a microphone. But
that's a nice one.
And in the Zoom F8n, it takes the piano, the Kronos, and I depend according to what I want to do. I use massively Cubase.
Okay,
great. And Ableton also.
Ableton.
So plus with VST, mainly Omnisphere, that is really interesting as a range of possibilities, but also many things about modifying the sound of a piano can be done partially or totally within the Kronos, partially filtering the sound once it we have a RAW, so like when you have a RAW file, a RAW photo with Photoshop. Mm-hmm. So it depends, it's according to my necessities. So, but this is the main chain with which I work, and also with which the latest releases are done. It's also true that also during the pandemic, to try to merge things, I recorded home here in Malta, also because there was a lockdown. And for the mixing and mastering, I based it on a professional studio in Italy. So it is a hybrid. So I didn't, for small productions, small things, I do my own mixing and mastering and so on. But for works like Island or Black Sheep,
you go to a bigger studio.
C Sharp. Yes. So, and I saw that the compromise, in my opinion, worked in a really reasonable way, because nowadays they can be compromised. Above all, I'm lucky to work with a very good sound engineer, so that is a really game changer in some cases.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting that the home studios today, you can capture so much, you can capture a lot of your ideas, right, at home. And pretty good quality. And, and then once you get to mastering, it's a different skill. Like a recording engineer, they go to school for that. There's a certain skill level to that. And, trying to do what they do, I'm the artist, they're like, that's an art in itself.
Yes, this is why I don't pretend to, like for Island, I don't pretend I do everything. And no, because of course I do for the pre-production. But for important works, despite the pandemic and lockdowns, thanks also to modern technology and the possibilities of file sizes.
There's a lot of stuff you can do. I've bought a bunch of equipment over the years that allow me to, I can get Neve audio processing. That's a lot of what a recording engineer is going to do. He's going to use a Neve board and he's going to run it through a bunch of Neve equipment, he's going to get a really good sound. Like it came out of Sound City, and that kind of references. There was this big analog Neve board, famous board for recording, in like Los Angeles, right? And Fleetwood Mac and a bunch of big bands used it, like Tom Petty used it, and this is a phenomenal analog mixing console. And I think the Foo Fighters own it now. They actually bought it. It's an analog board. It's not a digital board. And it had a sound quality that created like Fleetwood Mac's like Rumors album. If you listen to that album, it sounds phenomenal. It has a sound in it that, and you also listen to Tom Petty, Damn the Torpedoes. It has a certain sound. And even Nirvana's first record was recorded there. And so there's a certain level of sound that comes off of that stuff, the processing that's used to do that. And it's like, it's a certain skill set, but it's also the equipment. I'm a big believer, I guess, in some analog equipment. I would say there's certain analog equipment that creates a sound that is like, it's legendary. Like there's certain microphones that if you're a singer, you want to use that mic, like a C414 or U57. There's certain SM57. There's certain things in music that like you got to go to the studio because you don't have it.
Yes. Like for me, using some Neumann, that would be really out of budget.
Yeah. I guess like I can't get like a $25,000 mic. I don't have the money for that.
Yes, no, definitely no. I agree. I totally agree with you.
You know, so I was like, I guess I can't have that. I'm like, I have a virtual version of it, but you know, it's not the same. But yes. I thank you very much for being on the program, Leonardo.
Thank you for the invitation, Phantom. I really appreciated this chat, and it was really inspiring. So really, thank you.
Well, we want to let everybody know we've got the website link to your website. So anything new you're pushing, everybody, you know, go to the website, because your new single is going to be like, you'll have a link there, right?
Yes. There is the link in a new release in albums. So there will be this single that will be out on Wednesday, and it will be this collaboration with Marco Minnemann. So if you don't know who Marco Minnemann is, go to check his music.
Go check it out.
Really a god level drummer, an impressive drummer. So I'm very happy to release this small collaboration.
So that's like next Wednesday?
So everybody should
check out the link on here. This is a permanent link. You can't click on it, but go and type it out. And on Wednesday, go check that out. Go buy it, download it, stream it, tell other people about it. Because this is one thing we tell everybody, that if you're into a musician, you should not only stream it, you should download it, you should buy it, you should tell other people, you should hit the like button, right? You should follow the artist, you should subscribe to their channel, because in the same way that you follow a YouTuber, you know, treat musicians in the same way. Subscribe to them, donate to them, buy their merch, buy their t-shirts, buy whatever they're selling on their website, because that's how you support musicians, because it takes a lot of work. There's a lot of practice. There's a lot of effort going into everybody that is a musician. And everybody we talk to, we always tell people, if you love the musicians that you listen to, support them. And that's just the last little lesson for today.
Totally agree. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much for being on, and we'll hope to talk to you again. It was great. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Have a good day. Bye.